Good afternoon. Am I audible? Can you hear me? Ah, thanks. Asha says she can hear me. So, yes, let us begin. The year is coming to an end tomorrow. We've had a very, very exciting year, I would say. And we have now on the threshold of 2024. Incidentally, you know, we used to call it the calendar year. We used to say that calendar year 2023. But then calendars seem to have almost gone out of fashion. Who uses calendars anymore? We are all, everything is there in our mobiles and our laptops and in soft copy and all that. But you remember those good old days where you used to have very nice picturesque calendars, you know, with lovely photos and this and that. Hardly the era is changing, but anyway, we keep referring it to as the calendar year. Now, today I thought we'll take up this topic of, you know, how do we welcome 2024? I'm not going to talk about these cliches of what we call as New Year resolutions and what we should do and all that. Let us understand, or at least make an attempt to understand, what 2024 can bring for us. We have always been understanding the fact that the only permanent thing in life is change. That we know, that change is inevitable. Nothing else is permanent. Everything changes. So we normally say that the only permanent thing in life is change, right? Okay, that we have understood since a long time. But as I keep reminding, what about the rate of change? Oh my, the rate of change is so, so, so fast. And that is the reason why when people used to talk about what happened in this particular year or what happened in this particular century or decade and all that, I think those days are going. We have to now anticipate change at a very, very fast pace. And the other thing is application of change. Let's, you know, spend a few minutes talking about it. When in the good old days, a new invention used to come, let's say Thomas Edison or whoever invented the telephone in 1864. It took 20 years before the first city in the world, that is New York, got connected by telephones, which means 20 years after the invention of the telephone, people could actually, you know, start using phones at an individual level. Take aviation for that matter. The Wright brothers flew in the year, I think, 1903, if I'm not mistaken. And it took at least 10, 15 years before aircraft actually became available for people. In fact, in India, it came almost 50 years later when the first of the people could actually sit in an aircraft and travel somewhere. So that is how it was. Now what is happening? Go back to the end of 2022. I think it was 30th November when this interesting thing was announced called ChatGPT. By December, people who wanted to start using that ChatGPT had already started using it. I think before the year ended, within 30 days, there were millions of people using ChatGPT. This is just one example to show you how today's changes, any change that comes in, picks up like this. And this is not restricted to technology. It also includes lifestyles. A new lifestyle comes in and people jump at it within no time. Some new features in a mobile come which were not there earlier. The moment the new mobile comes, it's a matter of days before a huge segment of people are already using it to their advantage. So we do need to embrace technological changes. We can't run away from technology, but technology is becoming a little scary. And this time it is not oldies like me who are saying it. Even people who are deep in the technological world, even the techies, as we call it, some of them at least, have started cautioning that the latest changes can be very, very difficult challenges. And you know what I'm talking about. I'm talking about artificial intelligence. 2023 has been the year of artificial intelligence from the time ChatGPT came up. And we are already talking about students who have used artificial intelligence to copy in the exams or to make out their theses and projects. We are talking about artificial intelligence, how it is being used by unscrupulous elements to cheat others or to have financial benefits for themselves. All this has already started happening. We are talking about deep fakes and all these things. So in today's this thing, I just wanted to, you know, understand what are the changes that we can adapt to. But to be able to adapt to change, please remember, we have to anticipate change. And as a friend of mine said long back, change is good, but change based on experience is far better. Now, this is one of the most important things I wanted to share with you today. Are you learning from the past to anticipate and adapt to change? Or have we forgotten the past? And in this, I would like to bring up a very, very important aspect of our lives 3 years back, which was the corona and the lockdown. I need not repeat that nobody in the world had anticipated that such a lockdown will come. In fact, if somebody had said so a few days or a few weeks before the lockdown came, that the whole world is going to shut down within a matter of hours, they would have laughed at him and said, what an imagination, yeah. You've been seeing too many science fiction movies. This is the real world. Come to the real world. If we have not learned from that lesson last year, I forget the date, you can Google it and see. There was one particular day when the entire civil aviation in the great country of USA came to a standstill. Not a single commercial flight could take off for the whole day. I don't know the technicalities. I don't know why it happened, how it happened, and how it was set right. But can you imagine today, air travel has become something which we have taken for granted, and more so in a Western world. In a country like US, to them, air travel is the equivalent of we using maybe a cycle or a motorcycle. And the entire country, not a single civilian could catch any flight and go from one place to another. Now, these are the things which we need to take into account. What probably would have happened is somebody would have set right the glitch and flights would have resumed. Okay. And they would also have taken some precaution. The professionals, the people who manage those flights and all that, would have learned a lesson and they would have said, now we will prevent it by doing this or that, or this is how it should be, this is how we should ensure and all that. But what about the common man? What about the commuter who flies on a regular basis? Has he learned a lesson that tomorrow, if all flights are grounded, not for one day, but for 1 week or 1 month, how is life going to be? Can he even visualize it? We don't. And you know, one of the reasons why this happens is because we do not have that perseverance to look at things in a longer duration. Somehow, because life has become easy, because life has become convenient, because we are getting things at the touch of a button or whatever you call it, we have started presuming that everything will be taken for granted. Within one generation, we have gone from the era of people saving money for a rainy day. A person who gets employed would start off on a very low salary. Slowly his salary would go up. Then he would start saving money month after month, year after year, till he could afford to buy a plot. Then he would buy a plot, be very happy that now I have a place where I can build a house, maybe in a few years. So now I'm collecting money to build the house. Few years later, he builds a very basic house and he moves his family in. And then he says, I will try and save some more money so that I can expand this house so my children grow up, they will be needing their own rooms. Or I can make one more portion upstairs and I can rent it out and use the rent for my retirement years. That's how it used to go. Today, a youngster gets a job in an MNC and next day there are real estate people chasing him saying that, why don't you buy or book or move into a brand new apartment? What about the earnest money for the rest of it? You'll give me a loan. There was a time when you had to pay 25% earnest money and somebody would give you 75% loan. They say, no, you don't need anything. You just move in. Here are the keys. Now, in this scenario, what is happening is, one important thing is our perseverance, our steadfastness, our ability to delay gratification and to still maintain our spirit, that is slowly and steadily going down. This is represented in a very nice little, you know, video, which I happened to pick up over the internet. I thought maybe we can all share it and have a look. This is about birds, you know, whom we can consider to be much inferior to us. But look at the way birds can teach us perseverance. Have you ever observed the behavior of birds in the face of adversity? Please do. We have so much to learn from them. For days and days, they make their nests, sometimes gathering material brought from far away, which none of us do. We only order a book. And when they have completed the nest and are ready to lay eggs, the weather or the work of humans or some animal destroys it and it falls to the ground. All that they have done with so much effort is gone in one split second. Do they stop, bewildered, and leave the work saying that after all our efforts, it's gone? No, they don't. They start over building the nest again and again until they have eggs in the nest once more. Sometimes, and very often before the chicks are hatched, an animal, a child, or a storm destroys the nest once again. But this time with its valuable contents, the eggs are gone. It hurts to go back to begin again. Even so, the birds do not ever stop. They continue to sing and build and keep singing and building once more. Do you sometimes get the feeling that your life, your work, your family is not what you had dreamed of? Do you sometimes want to say, enough? Effort is not worthwhile. It's all too much for me. Are you tired of it all? Do you feel that the daily struggle is a waste of time? your trust has been betrayed by somebody, your goals have not reached just before you are about to get them. It happens to all of us, no? Life strikes you down sometimes. But do you go on, say a prayer, put your faith in hope, not in darkness? Do not worry if you get injured in the battle, that is to be expected. Gather yourself together and rebuild your life so that it runs well again. No matter what happens, do not shrink back, but move forward. Life is a constant challenge, but it is worthwhile to mostly accept it and never stop singing. That is what we learn from the birds. If we understand very simple and very basic things and we work on it, we will be able to anticipate change. When the change is for the good, when better things are happening, we are very happy. And we think that things will always go on and on being good. But it doesn't happen that way. In all our lives, there are setbacks. We don't know what setbacks 2024 will bring for us. Are we continuously learning and upskilling? This is one thing which is very, very important. Forget about the calendars. Forget about which year it is. Are you upskilling yourself? Are you not just learning, but unlearning and relearning whatever you had learned in the past? Unless you do that, you will find that the future starts getting gloomier and gloomier. Are you taking care of your time? Are you doing time management? That's the one thing which never comes back. You lose money, you can get it back. Your health goes back, you can improve on it. Your relationship goes back, you build on it. But time never comes back. So are you confidently, with capability, managing your time well so that you appreciate and value the time? At the same time, let me also tell you, if this year has been the year of artificial intelligence, to you and me, it should be the year of emotional intelligence. Behavioral scientists have already told us 80-90% of your success, fulfillment, etc., will be based on how good your emotional intelligence is. And no artificial intelligence can overtake your emotional intelligence. Artificial intelligence can take over your cognitive intelligence, but not your emotional intelligence. And emotional intelligence can be built at any stage of your life, regardless of your age. So can you set this target for yourself, that knowing that 2024 will get a lot of changes, unanticipated changes? I was mentioning a little while back about the COVID and the lockdown. Do you know, in the last few days, people have already started talking about one more phase of COVID. We already hear that there are so many cases, so many people have died. What is happening? What do you think will happen? Have you anticipated? Have you thought of what could be happening? What happens if there's another surge and there is a lockdown? How well prepared are you? Have you learned lessons? You sat at home for 2 years because of the lockdown and because of the COVID. But did you, when things came back to normalcy, learn a lesson from it and say, if next time it happens, this is how I am going to tackle it? I have been asking people, and almost everybody who I talk to says, I have never thought of it. I don't think it's going to come back. Your thinking makes no difference. Time keeps moving on. Unexpected things do happen. If it is not COVID, it could be a tsunami. It could be just about anything under the sun. It could be a war. We had thought that we have overcome wars and this and that, and we have moved to a civilized society. Today, two huge wars are taking place in the globe. And just because they are not happening very close to us doesn't mean that We can be complacent. You don't know when you will be thrust into some war. You can check if you want. People in Russia, people in Ukraine, people in Palestine, people in Israel. Did they anticipate that such a huge war will be happening in 2023? Tens of thousands of people will be dying. They're not anticipated. It is always that NIMBY syndrome, no, not in my backyard type of thing. Life keeps moving on and on. But as I said, do we learn lessons from life? There was a very touching small little video of a situation, an incident between an old father and his grown-up son. Have a look at it. Anis is putting it on. The language is foreign, but there are subtitles that you can see that. Here is this very old father sitting with his son. His son is busy reading some newspaper or something. The father is just looking around and he sees a sparrow. He asks the son, what is it?
That's what you mean.
And the son looks at it and says, a sparrow. Oh. Few seconds later, the father sees the sparrow a little closely and says, what is that? The son says, I just told you it is a sparrow. The sparrow flies from one tree to another and has gone up, and the father is looking at it very carefully and again turns to the son. He looks at it closely and he says, what is that? The son is now getting impatient. A sparrow, father, a sparrow, S-P-A-R-R-O-W, sparrow. Why are you doing this? I told you so many times that it's a sparrow. Can't you get it? Father gets up and starts walking. And the son says, where are you going? The father just gestures to him, saying, hold on. And the old man walks into the house. Son is wondering, what happened? Is he hurt? Is he upset? Why has he walked off? But the father comes back. And he's carrying a diary with him. He opens the diary and gives it to the son. Old diary. He gives it to the son and says, read that particular page.
Dinata.
Then he tells him, read loudly. And the son reads out. Today, my youngest son, who is a few days old, turned 4, was sitting with me at the park when a sparrow sat in front of me. My son asked me 21 times what it was. And I explained to him. I told him it's a sparrow. I hugged him every single time he asked me the same question. Again and again. Without getting mad, feeling affection for my innocent child, explaining to him the same thing over and over. And that really hits the son, that this is reality. He gives a hug to his father, realizing what he has done. How life changes. Why have I shown you this? Because I want you to understand. Today, a father who is very much in control of his life, and he has this innocent small child who's going on asking him, what is that? And the father has to explain 21 times that it is a sparrow. Some day may come when the father becomes very old. The son has grown up and now becomes somebody very capable. And the father's memory is fading. The father's cognition is fading. And the father keeps asking the son, what is that? 3 times he asked him the same question, what is that? And by the 3rd or 4th time, the son gets very impatient. And he says, why are you doing this to me? Why are you repeating the same question? Time and again, he doesn't have that patience. This is what true life is all about. Go back into the past. Once upon a time, you were also an innocent, naive, and vulnerable little child. Today, just because you are grown up, you are an adult, you are in control of your life, you are earning, or you are a homemaker, or whatever you are, do you think life will be that way throughout? Don't you understand that the cycle will change again and again? Be with nature. Develop gratitude. Can you please wind up this year by making a list of the people who made 2023 happy and fulfilling for you? Make a list. Spend the next 2 days adding as many people as you can. People who did small gestures, people who did big gestures, people who didn't have to be necessarily nice to you, but they were nice to you. Make it into a gratitude journal and say, as I begin the new year, I am going to express my gratitude to all those who made the year which has gone past better than what it would have been without them. How much time are you spending with nature? Are you willing to make a target, a goal to say in 2024, I am going to spend more and more time with nature, wherever, whenever, however it is possible? If we disassociate with nature, we are going to pay a very heavy price for it. In whatever form. And nature doesn't mean going 1,000 miles away to some hill station or beach or resort or whatever it is. You step out of the house, you will see nature. You go to the local park, you will see nature. You drive out 10 or 20 miles from the city, you will see nature. But please do not take nature for granted. Otherwise, we'll continue to have COVIDs and tsunamis and earthquakes and wars and whatever it is. If we learn to value nature and understand that we are the children of nature, nature is our parent, nature controls us. And if we are going to have that gratitude towards nature, gratitude towards the people who have been good to me, I think we'll be doing wonders. And before I end the first half of this session, my request, my exhortation, which I've already been doing, please start cutting down your screen time. I know I'm talking on the screen and it's an oxymoron, but we can't help it. Please start spending less and less time in front of any screen, be it a mobile, be it a tablet, be it a laptop, or be it a TV, or be it a cinema theater. Please reduce screen time. Look out. There's a huge world waiting for you. And 2024 is going to bring in a lot of changes which you will be able to anticipate, which you will be able to adapt, and which you will be able to enjoy if you have that mindset. That is a sincere request to all of you. Please spread this message, how we can welcome 2024 with change, with nature, with gratitude, and with anticipation of whatever the year is going to bring to us. Okay. So I'll take a minute off. Sonal is here to update you on what's happening in Banjara.
Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon. Nice to see so many of them every week after week, listening to Ali and, enriching your lives. It's really beautiful getting messages in different forms, applying them and bringing in change to our lives. Slowly, subtly, so many changes we are bringing from years after years and past, I think, 3-4 years through Facebook. So many of you are able to get that advantage, right? And as Ali was telling about bringing in change and enriching our own 2024 year, which is coming soon. And luckily, I feel this year we have that opportunity because 31st is Sunday and 1st is also Monday. So we have 2 days of spending time with nature and avoiding the screen. We generally, on the 31st, we tend to watch different programs and somehow wait for 12 o'clock and then wish each other Happy New Year and then you sleep. So you're sleeping with just wishing for the next year, but what about the introspection of what happened in 2023? And if at all, and definitely every year changes do come, what are we doing to prepare ourselves? I think those kind of discussions can be done sitting in a garden or just sitting on the terrace along with the sky, with the stars, with a group of people whom you would like to spend your last day of the year with. And then have that kind of discussion. I feel that can bring you more closer also. You can bring, not only do the party where you eat and sing and dance. Yes, that's part of celebration. But before that, before 12 o'clock, all this can be done where you have discussion of, you know, what happened in 2023, which each one of them, how did they deal with it, whom they would like to give gratitude to, whom they have missed out on giving gratitude in 2023 and now they will look forward to give in 2024. And I think time will just go. And then at 12 o'clock, have your celebration. Welcome the new year. I'm just giving ideas. It's up to you to give me more ideas next week. Yeah, it will be pleasure to know what each one has done on that 31st, which was different and without the screen, right? And we will look forward for the next week's topic also. Anis, can you put on the next week topic? Finding the right mentor. I think that is also so very important. That can be a new change where you adapt to what a mentor is telling you and taking guidance. And I would say, I think what I say will make everybody jealous. But yeah, we have our mentor from, I think, 15, 16 years. And still there is thirst to learn more and more from him. And it's none other than Dr. Ali. And I'll give back the screen to him.
Thank you, Sonal. That was a nice compliment to me. If I can be a mentor to somebody, I would feel privileged. But coming back to the topic of today, let us start off with your comments and your questions. Both we need to. Of course, there are a lot of good afternoons. There are more good afternoons to Sonal than to me. So, but I don't feel jealous because I also love Sonal's company and Sonal's whenever I have an interaction with Sonal, right? Okay, Asha says, sometimes I feel it's the same, like moving in concentric circles. But yes, I would like to be in the teaching and learning profession. Very relevant point that Asha has brought out. Sometimes I feel it's the same, like moving in concentric circles. You know, we talk about that maze or the puzzle which is given to rats when they are experimenting. The rats keep going round and round, round and round in that maze, trying to find a way to escape out of it. But actually, in reality, there's no escape. They move into this and they take a round. Nothing happens. They move into the next one and they take a round and they come back to where they had started off. And that is how the word or the phrase developed, which is called the rat race. The rats are racing all the time, thinking that I will find some outlet. If I keep running fast enough, I will find a way to get out of this maze. Many, many, many human beings are caught in that rat race. And as I always keep reminding you, even if you win the rat race, you are still a rat. Would you not like to do something different? Okay. Kanchana Kumari says, good afternoon, Ali. Today's topic was very good and useful. Thank you. Yes, I'm really happy that if there's something little that we can have a takeaway. Half an hour, 1 hour is not very difficult, and that too on a Saturday afternoon. And as you know, you can tell your friends, if you have friends who are not free at 2 o'clock on Saturdays, they can watch this later anytime they want to. It's available. It doesn't disappear. Only advantage of being here at 2 o'clock on the Saturday is that we can have an interaction. You can give your comments, you can ask your question. That's the main advantage to us. Okay. Sunita says, love the idea of gratitude. Yes, Sunita, I think all of us should build that culture, that thinking, that attitude of gratitude, meaning to say, look for the smallest things that people give. Last weekend, I remember we had gone to a restaurant. It was not one of the really top restaurants, but some friend recommended, saying that they have good food. We went there. There was this gentleman, you know, the waiter, he must have been 50 plus, with such a sweet smile on his face. And the moment he came, he started talking to us as though we are not his customers, but his guests. He started recommending. He said, would you like this? Do you prefer this? Would you like, you know, this will go very good with that. The moment we made a request, get us an extra plate or get us this, he would give such a sweet smile and say, just a minute, I'll get it. And he would go running and he would get that thing for us. Throughout the meal, he was hovering around near us and the other customers sitting there. It was so amazing. I very, very rarely come across such waiters. And that too, a person who's not all that young, he can't run around like a 20-year-old waiter would be able to do, but he did it. Now, why does he do it? He is getting whatever salary he is getting. Maybe he gets a few tips here and there, but I'm sure that's also not anything great. But he has made that, you know, attitude towards life, that these are my customers, these are my guests. I'd like to send them off happy. If they go happy, I am happy. That's what we should develop, that thing of gratitude. Whenever we come across somebody as simple as a waiter who goes out of the way to be nice to us. Okay. Asha says, the thought of Mr. Lokesh at NIOS office, Malleshwaram, brings back smile. Remembering him along with students of SKEI school, where I work, who have quirky sense of humor. That's what I'm saying. See, government offices, for example, we always complain that they are rude, they are inattentive, they are impatient, they are even corrupt and all that. Here is one school, I mean an office, the NIOS, National Institute of Open Schooling. It's a Government of India office. They are all employees of the Government of India with all their job security and whatever else is there. But you go there, you don't feel that it's a government office. People like Mr. Lokesh and so many others over there, his predecessors and all these people, they're genuinely interested in the welfare of children. They want to promote good learning and good education. And you go to them with the weirdest of questions, they have the patience to answer. Now, do we have the gratitude? When somebody is not good at us, when we go to a government office where something, you know, we are not treated properly, how quick we are at criticizing, shouting, blaming. But when something so nice happens, can we express that gratitude in whatever little way? For the new year, Can you send them a message? Can you send them a card? Can you send them a chocolate or whatever? It is just to show my gratitude that I have had dealings with your office and I was treated so well. Surekha says, what kind of supporting network can we develop in order to adapt to change? Yes, Surekha, I think this is an excellent question. Surekha always comes out with very thought-provoking things. The type of supporting network. If we have a good supporting network, no, we can adapt to change very well. Why? Because we cannot be an expert in everything, right? For example, let me frankly tell you, I'm technologically challenged. Anything new like this, even a simple thing like this, FB Live, etc., etc., I depend on my colleagues. Every Saturday, without fail, before 2 o'clock, Anis is here. She sets up everything right from what would be the appropriate lighting to the angle to whatever is needed. And she sits here. You don't see her, but she's here the whole 1 hour till we complete and wind up. Now, this is my supporting network. There are so many people behind the scenes. I told them that, you know, talking 1 hour nonstop becomes a little, you know, strenuous for me. And I'm sure people also get fed up seeing my face throughout the hour. So I came up with this idea that can we have a 2-minute break? And, you know, we can be updated on what's happening in Banjara. So every Saturday without fail, either it is Sonal or it is Purnima, they come here, they give me that break. They're also busy, they've got their own work. But they come and do this for me. They have no reason to do it. They can say, Ali, it's your baby. You spend the whole hour there. Now, this is what I mean as a supporting network. That 2 minutes that I get from Sonal, Purni, Anis, whoever comes in the break, gives me that little thing. I go and have a half a cup of tea or a little Pepsi or whatever it is. So network can be built up, and always value every member of your network. A person like Adil, who is promptly there exactly at 2:30 with the tea or Pepsi, whatever I've asked him to bring for me, he's my support network. Without him, I'll be deprived of that drink and maybe I'll feel a little more tired or a little more, you know, sleepy in the afternoon. Yes. Surekha also, yeah, this we've already answered. Supporting network in order to adapt to change. Okay, Roshan says, I do agree with Sonal that my mentor in old age is Dr. Ali. Okay, old age of Roshan or old age of Ali, I will not ask that because I have gone far beyond old age. But yes, whenever somebody acknowledges, I really feel touched. That in whatever way. And remember, it's not that one person has to be the mentor all the time. The mentee can become the mentor sometimes in certain things. That's what I was telling them. When we talk about the supporting network, that everybody has certain, you know, specializations, certain unique abilities. And if we develop our network by taking advantage of those skills which the other person has, and in return giving the other person what they want, we can do wonders. Surekha says, resilience helps us to navigate through change. Very true. But when we are down in the dumps, when we are vulnerable, resilience is too hard a strength to cultivate. Yes, Surekha, I agree with you. But you know something? Don't wait to develop resilience when you are down in the dumps. Develop resilience now if life is going very, very smoothly. This is what I was telling you in another form by saying, today, people buy extremely expensive houses or apartments with an EMI which runs into 15 years. And if something goes wrong, they are in trouble. If they lose their job or if they are not able to pay. The earlier generation who used to save money and then build their house never had that worry. Because they have no liability. They have saved their hard-earned money and then come out, isn't it? Now, that was for money or housing. The same thing can be done for building our emotional and mental resilience. I am a very strong believer that the best time for change is when change is not needed. Keep this as a, you know, underlying philosophy for 2024. If things are going well, that's the time to think about change. If Corona comes, if this happens, if I fail in the exam, if I have a financial setback, if I build that resilience now, whenever it comes, I will be able to handle it. Yeah, Madhavi says, first time I am the first to join the session today. I want to make a change. I want to be in time wherever I go. Wonderful, Madhavi. I heartily welcome you, and I heartily welcome that, you know, role modeling that you are doing. There are so many people who do want to participate in this, but they are catching up with something at the last moment, and then they miss out something. Now, like Madhavi did today, I know that 2 o'clock I'm going to be starting. You know that Ali will start exactly at 2. So what's wrong if 2 minutes, 5 minutes before 2, I log in and I just sit and wait. I just, you know, do some deep breathing or close my eyes and relax. And I know that it's just a matter of 1, 2, 3 minutes and the session starts, and I'm there fully involved with it from the beginning. Roshan says, I have green fingers, and whatever I sow reaps good results without any effect, as my soil is very fertile. So happy being with nature and variety of fruits, which I distribute among friends, gives me immense pleasure. This also keeps me in good health. See, here's a wonderful little example. You have a little garden, utilize it. You have some open space, instead of concreting it and making it into a driveway or whatever it is, keep it open and grow some plants in it. It's not so difficult. You don't have open space, do it on your balcony, do it on your terrace. But even that connect with nature takes you a long way. Asha says, what holds us in 2024 may be unknown for some of us, but what matters is how we gather our wits and move forward if we have to continue to sail in life. Fantastic. I think that's a very, very good sign. Now, these are some of the things which, as I said, they stimulate my thinking. I prepare well in advance for days and weeks before the session. That's why, you know, that we fix up sessions 1 month, 2 months in advance. So I keep fixing up, I keep adding up, and you know, till the last moment, I keep chatting it out with my friends, colleagues, whoever I meet with. And then I come on every Saturday at 2 o'clock. But after 2:30, the feedback, the inputs, the comments, even the questions that I get give me so much of significance. It enhances me. And that, I think, is the crux of life. As one of you said, constant learning, constant unlearning and relearning. And that happens to me very often. Sometimes I feel very strongly that this is how life should be. If I make up my mind in 2024, this is what I'm going to do, this is what I like, this is what it is. But I suddenly learn a lesson. No, I don't think this is appropriate. I don't think I should be doing it this way. Maybe there's a better way of doing it. And that too, when somebody, you know, lights the way for me, somebody gives a comment like we get in the chat box, somebody whom I'm meeting just comes out with a personal experience, you know, Ali, I did this, and this is where I failed, or this is where I succeeded. Either way, it gives me that boost. And I say, yes, now I'm going to find a change in the direction, and I'm going to continue on a different path. I'm going to change the speed of my, you know, progress. I'm going to slow down at points. I'm going to take a break at times. Everything directly or indirectly helps you to move on to a better quality of life. And that is what I wish for all of you, that I hope, wish, and pray that the year 2024 brings you not that standard thing of happiness and joy which everybody wishes everybody, but more of fulfillment, more of serenity, more of peace, more of a sense of satisfaction, more connectedness with human beings, other living beings, and with nature, and therefore with the universe. This is my greeting and my wish to all of you, and let us look forward. We will meet now only in the next year, which is going to be on 6th January, with the topic finding the right mentor. So you also please work on it. Send me in advance if you have some ideas of it, you know, points or something that you would like to share, which have been your experiences. I would love to incorporate that in the talk. And of course, whatever else I get, I'll present it to you. And then we will have a lively discussion in the second half. I'm getting a lot of happy, fulfilled New Year, you know, messages, not only to me, but to everybody in Banjara. We will convey this to all the team members in Banjara. Thank you very much. Bye-bye. See you next year.